Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of the Lord Jesus, and thank you that we have to look forward to that great promise that you made when you said that you are coming again. This same Jesus shall return in like manner. The angel told the disciples on the day your son ascended into your presence. And as we think about the culmination of that promise tonight, or anticipate it, we just entrust our time to you. So in the Savior's name we come to you. Amen. Well, we are in Revelation chapter 19, and let me just make a couple of introductory comments. You'll notice in your outline kind of structure of where we are with the I'm sorry, it's not the way I thought I printed it off, but it is what it is. We are coming to the fall of Babylon, chapter 17 and 18. And then we have this little section, verses 1 to 10 of chapter 9. And different people divide things different ways. Some stick them on the end of chapter 18. Some put them into chapter 19. I've just sort of compromised and made them a separate little section in the middle here. But this is transitional. This is moving from the judgment that God has poured out in terms of the Babylon and the woman, and now the final culmination when he returns in glory to the earth. So by the time we're finished chapter 19, the Lord Jesus has his feet, although it's never said, standing on earth, having returned in glory and in power. And in this first 10 verses, it kind of looks both ways. The first part looks back to celebrate the fall of Babylon. The second part looks forward to anticipate, specifically, the marriage supper of the Lamb. This great moment about which nothing is much further said, and yet it's something that's highly anticipated. And we'll see that as we get to where we're going. Now, in the passage, as you have it in front of you, you'll notice that it is structured around a number of times we have the word hallelujah. It's interesting that these are the only times we have the word hallelujah in the New Testament. They all occur here four times in direct form and one other time. So in verse 1, we have hallelujah. That stands out pretty obviously. In verse 3, once more they cried out, hallelujah. And in right at the very end of verse 4, saying, amen, hallelujah. And then the beginning of verse 5, praise our God, which is almost exactly hallelujah, except the word is added into it. The word our is added into it. And then in verse 6, hallelujah. So we have, depending on how you want to count here, five hallelujah choruses, or four if you're a stickler specifically for the word hallelujah. Again, there's a question about verse 5, just to anticipate. Does verse 5 belong, as the ESV has it, with verse 4? Or does verse 5 introduce verse 6? It, on one level, it doesn't really matter, but it's pretty obvious. In verse 5, you have, and from the throne came a voice saying, praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude. So I'm taking verse 5 with verse 6 because it seems to me verse 5 is the command and verse 6 is the response, but nothing is dependent on thinking it that way as against the other way. So let's read the first four verses. After this, I heard what seemed to be the loud voice of a great multitude in heaven crying out, "Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, for his judgments are true and just, for he's judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality and has avenged on her the blood of his servants." Once more they cried out, "Hallelujah! The smoke from her goes up forever and ever." And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God, who was seated on the throne, saying, "Amen. Hallelujah." I was somewhere the other day and suddenly realized that how many of you just for real, this is a very theological question, and I want you to understand that it's very theological and tells you a lot about your spiritual life. How many of you say amen? How many of you say amen? How many of you just shift back and forth because whatever feels good? How many of you have never thought about it before? I was in a place where everybody said one and I was saying to myself the other. So I thought, it's interesting. I didn't know whether that was a Canadian thing or just divisional thing. Anyway, all of that really important stuff. Let's just notice this first section. And you'll notice on your outline, God is to be praised for what he's done. The righteous destruction of Babylon, verses 1 to 4. So it begins with that statement, after this. After what? Well, after the mighty angel in verse 21 picked up a stone like a millstone, threw it into the sea, saying, and he talks about, so will Babylon, the great city, be thrown down. And it goes on to talk about its utter silence because death has fallen upon it. And then the reasons for it at the end of verse 23 and 24. For your merchants were the great ones of the earth. All nations were deceived by your sorcery. In her was found the blood of prophets and of saints and all of those who've been slain on the earth. So the first cycle of praise is in verses 1 and 2. And it follows on the fall of Babylon, and that's what it seems. And John says, I heard what seemed to be the loud voice of a great multitude in heaven. The what seems to be is probably because he doesn't see it. He just hears it. And so he's saying, you know, I heard this. I didn't get to see where it was coming from. But it is obviously the multitude of the redeemed who are celebrating what God has done in this particular time. And they cry out, hallelujah. Now, let me just pause for a little bit here and think about the word hallelujah, because there's an important little note in it, even though we don't think about it very often. The Hebrew word hallelujah occurs 24 times in the Old Testament, always in the book of Psalms. And hallelujah is two Hebrew words. Hallelujah, and of course we pronounce this like a Y. This word, hallel, means to boast or to praise. The central meaning of the word is to boast about something. And then this is simply the name of God, Yah, and you can see Yahweh as the part of that. Now, when you put this word into Greek, for some reason, the Greeks don't have a letter H, but they do pronounce, anyway, for some reason, they put a smooth breathing rather than a rough breathing, so it comes across as alleluia. So sometimes You'll see it written as Alleluia, other times Hallelujah, as far as the original language is concerned. It says Alleluia, but everybody knew it was pronounced Hallelujah because that's what it is in Hebrew. Now, think about this for a minute. What is Hallelujah in terms of its original meaning? By the way, just to pick this up, I should. Beginning in Psalm 111, you have a series of what are called the Hallel Psalms. They're called that because a number of them, not all of them, but a number of them begin with the word Hallelujah. And some of them end with Hallelujah. And Psalm 118 was the last of those. So early in the, So one of what makes this intriguing is that it was Jewish custom to recite the Hallel Psalms at Passover time. And the last psalm that they would pronounce, that they would recite before the meal ended and the evening ended, was Psalm 118. Now, do you remember what it says about the night the Lord was betrayed? At the ending, what does it say about the ending of that evening? After they had sung a psalm, they went out. It's worthwhile. Let's just look at Psalm 118 for a minute. This is it's really striking to read this now and hear these words and think of Jesus knowing in a way the disciples didn't understand that he was going out to Garden of Gethsemane and then to Calvary. So just to jump in, verse 19, just for the sake of jumping in somewhere. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of Yahweh. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Does that ring any bell to you? This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day Yahweh has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, O, we pray, O Yahweh. You know what that is in Hebrew? Hosanna, Yahweh. That's where the shout Hosanna comes from, this verse. Now that was the beginning of the word. Hosanna means save us, O Lord. Or save us now, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of Yahweh. We bless you from the house of Yahweh. Yahweh is good. He's made his light to shine upon us. Bind the festival sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God. I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to Yahweh, for he is good. For his steadfast love endures forever. Now, I don't know. I think there's every reason to believe, but you can't prove it, that those were the words that Jesus sang going out that evening. And every time I think of that phrase, this is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I think of the Lord taking that those words on his tongue as he was going about and then bind the sacrifice on the altar as a kind of prayer. So anyway, but to go back to the word, praise the Lord. What is that? What is praise the Lord as a statement? What is it? It's a command, isn't it? Praise the Lord. And if you think about Hallel, boast. Boast about the Lord. You don't boast about the Lord by saying hallelujah. Hallelujah is a command. Praise the Lord. I praise the Lord because he has been good to me and he has been gracious and so forth. So hallelujah is a kind of call to give content. At a certain point in my life, I was a little bit of a stickler on this, and somebody would say hallelujah at something and I would say, go right ahead. Because hallelujah, it came to be and it was used by the Jews as a shout of joy. And that's the way we usually use it, as a shout of joy. But its essential meaning is praise the Lord. Do it. Get about doing it. And that's exactly what happens here now. You'll notice the call to praise the Lord turns to the reason to praise the Lord. Because salvation, and here it probably has the sense of victory in terms of the defeat of Babylon, victory and glory, his weight, his importance, and power belong to our God. For his judgments are true and just. Now, this becomes a very important part, and it's said a number of times in the book of Revelation that God's judgments are according to truth and according to his promises. He is faithful, that is, he's reliable, he will do what he says. And in that sense, it is that he is going to judge those who are persecuting his people. He promised that. And they are true. They are in accordance with reality. So the righteousness of God, and we're going to see that, and we move by the end of this chapter, two people will be in the lake of fire. And all of that begins by saying, your judgments are faithful and true. And Babylon has been destroyed, and it is according with God's justice and his character. Now, you'll notice that then he gives two specific reasons. His judgments are just and true and just for, or because, he's judged the great prostitute who corrupted the earth with her immorality. And this is a new word, corrupted. It's been evident that she's the great corrupter, but this is the point of the judgment. The corrupter has been corrupted. She has experienced what is rightfully due her. And then the other thing that is praised for specifically, he's judged the great prostitute and he's avenged on her the blood of his servants. It's not so much revenge, I'm going to get you back for what you've done, although there is an element of that. It is that he has righteously given them what they deserve. And Babylon is reaping what she has sown, and she's receiving that. But there's a very important part in this. If you remember in the book of Romans, chapter 12, Paul talks about how believers are to live their life. And he says, don't render evil for evil. Don't seek vengeance, for vengeance belongs to the Lord. It's hard as a Christian to live by that standard. I want to get back. You know, as my old rugby coach used to tell me, you know, don't get mad, get even. And that's built into all of our instinct. He never really meant that. He always said, get even and a little bit more. But do it within the rules and don't get caught and don't get penalized for it. But the point is, it's an act of faith to say, I'm going to live trusting and obeying the Lord even when I am being wronged, not to avenge, not to come back and get my own. And vengeance is delayed, but it is certain. And that's what they are praising God for. His time has come. Babylon has gotten the deserts that she so richly has. So that's the first angelic chorus, and it's central affirmation is about the truthfulness of God's judgments, the righteousness of God's judgments, of giving what he deserves. Then the same group comes with the second hallelujah chorus. Once more they cried out, hallelujah. And now this time they're saying, in effect, her judgment is final and it's irreversible. Her smoke goes up forever and ever. I guess it's maybe true in certain places today, but in the ancient Near East, it was usually the inevitable thing that when you captured a city, you burned it, because they had no way to stop a fire. It just spread, and so you have the famous, and it wasn't related to a battle, but you have the famous fire of Rome that just spread through so much of Rome, and you have the Chicago fire in Chicago that spread through, and you have the London fires that destroyed most of London. That was sort of the end, and that's what is being celebrated here, that she is destroyed and she has gone. And then you have the third cycle in verse 4. 24 elders and the four living creatures. And we met them in chapter 4 as we were introduced to the one who was seated on the throne. And then these four living beings that seem to depict the most important of the angelic beings who are closest to the Lord. And then the 24 elders who are angelic beings and perhaps in some way represent God's people. And they fell down and worshiped God. It's interesting. The 24 elders, when we see them in chapter 4 and chapter 5, they're falling down all the time. The four living creatures, this is the first time they're said to fall down. Remember in chapter 4, it's every time the four living creatures said something, the 24 elders fell down. Here it's, they all do, and they worshiped God who was seated on his throne, saying, amen, hallelujah. Now, amen is simply a Hebrew word that means it is true. Yes is, we used to do that at church. Yes, very similar to what we say, yes. Amen is the kind of idea. And then hallelujah. It's interesting that that is a quotation, even though it looks just like two simple words, but it's the quotation from Psalm 106, which is a psalm that's the last psalm in book 5 of the Psalms. Blessed be Yahweh, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. And let all the people say, amen, praise the Lord. Or in Hebrew, amen, amen, hallelujah. And it's related to God having judged the nations and brought his people into deliverance in the psalm. So that's the first round of the hallelujah choruses in terms of honoring God. So let's just stop here and see if there's any threads or pieces or insights that you have that we want to look at in these first four verses. Okay. We press. Talking a little bit louder tonight because my voice feels a little bit better if I talk a little bit louder. So forgive me for overdoing it. So let's read verses 5 to 9. And from the throne came a voice saying, praise our God, all you his servants, you who fear him, small and great. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And the angel said to me, write this. Blessed are those who are invited. The Greek word is, blessed are those who have been called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. Now we'll come back to verse 10 in a moment. But here's the second thing. If God's people are to praise looking back at the destruction of Babylon and evil, now they are to praise anticipating what he's going to do in establishing his kingdom and in bringing into being this marriage and marriage supper of the Lamb. It's called both things in this particular passage. So, first of all, God is to be praised for the coming of his kingdom. Now, verse 5, from the throne came a voice saying, and there are some who says, well, if voice is coming from the throne, it must be God speaking. But that seems unlikely because the voice says, praise our God. So this seems to be an angel who is speaking from the very presence of God and is issuing this particular command. And the command goes out to all his servants. So, well, angelic beings are involved. It is primarily the redeemed, God's people, you who fear him. And that is the defining nature of his people. They revere him. They fear him. They hold him in awe. They hold him in reverence. And then John hears, and again, he's not seeing this, he is hearing this. I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty. And this next word is extremely difficult to communicate to you in English, but it is a past tense in Greek, but every commentator agrees that this is what is called an inceptive or a beginning aorist. I know that doesn't communicate anything, but the idea of it is the Lord our God has begun his reign. Now, there is a sense in which God has always reigned. But the essence of the book of Revelation is the unique reign of God manifested in its fullness on the earth. And if you remember back in chapter 11 and verse 15, we had the nation's reign, verse 15. Then the seventh angel blew his trumpet, and there was a loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. We mentioned before, seventh trumpet, but the seventh seal, the seventh trumpet, and the seventh bowls all come to the same time at the end point as Christ is about to come. So the kingdom of this world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. Now you have this double use of kingdom as you think about it, because it's clearly true, God has always reigned. And yet Jesus comes saying what? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. We're told to pray what in the Lord's Prayer? Your kingdom come. So there is a sense in which the king who is always the king and is eternally the king, there is a sense in which his kingdom is manifested. Now, as believers, God has translated us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of the Son whom he loves, Colossians chapter 1. And Matthew 13 will talk about a series of parables. One of the series of parables is the seed that is sown into the world, and then the tares grow up among it. And the command comes that you're not to separate the wheat and the tares until the end of the age. And then the Lord says, the sons of the kingdom will enter into the kingdom of the Lord. So the interesting thing is, in Matthew 13, the sons of the kingdom are present in the world before the kingdom is present in its manifested realm in the world. So when this says, hallelujah, for the Lord God, the Almighty, has begun his reign, it is anticipating the return of the Lord Jesus and the destruction of all of the evil influences, especially Babylon has been defeated. Now it is going to be the beast and the false prophet, and in chapter 20, Satan, who are all going to experience that particular thing. So this is not a statement about God's enduring reign, but it is about his manifested reign that is now coming as Christ comes as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as we'll have it in verse 16. Now, the other side of that, and we'll take a little bit more time on this, is the other anticipation. So, in verse 6, it's the kingdom. In verse 7, let us rejoice and exalt and give him the glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted to her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. And then the angel said to me, write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. So let me just notice three things here. The first is, this marriage and this marriage supper is future at this particular time. It hasn't yet taken. The groom, I want to come back to that moment, but the groom is clearly the Lamb. I mean, it's said, the marriage of the Lamb has come, and the bride is the church. Now, it's interesting as you think about this. In the Old Testament, in a number of occasions, Israel is talked about or spoken of as the wife of Yahweh. In Isaiah chapter 51, in Ezekiel chapter 16, in Hosea chapter 2, and there's several other places as well. Jeremiah. Every time in the Old Testament, that metaphor, because it's a metaphor, of the relationship between God and his people is given. So on one time, they're the flock of God. Another time, they're the wife and so forth. Every time in Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Hosea, the wife is unfaithful. And the picture is always of God restoring his adulterous people back to himself. So you remember Hosea especially. This is a big thing in Hosea that so Hosea is commanded to go and marry a woman who is a woman like Babylon, and she proves unfaithful, and he yet persists in his love even though he divorces her. She marries others and then has all of, but still there's God saying, I'm going to win you back. I'm going to restore you. I'm going to call you back into relationship to myself. In the New Testament, the picture of the bride and the Lord is given. Most obvious passage is what? Ephesians chapter 5. So you remember the husband should love their wives as Christ loved the church. And then it talks about the wife is to submit as the church does to the head, even Christ. And that picture, we'll come back to that in a moment because it's a significant picture. There's one other place in the New Testament that specifically speaks about the church in relationship to Christ and uses the bride or the marriage metaphor. And it's not nearly as well known. It's found in 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 2. He says, I feel a divine jealousy for you, since I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. Now, that means we need to step back, because behind this stands Jewish marriage practices. And it's useful to think about here. The first stage, on one level, not entirely different from ours, but the first stage was the stage of betrothal. Now, behind that, there was a negotiation of parents and all of the arranging that went on in those worlds that doesn't in ours. But finally, there was a betrothal based on a marriage contract and several other things that are unique to us. But from that time on, a man and woman were considered to be and spoken of as husband and wife. They hadn't consummated the marriage. They lived separately, but they were spoken of as husband and wife. Now, where does that become relevant in the Bible that you can think of? Joseph and Mary. And Joseph was going to do what to Mary? Divorce her privately, put her away privately. It's not like breaking an engagement where you just give the ring back. It's the kind of family story my mother used to say. Her sister gave the ring back so often to her final husband, it was like watching a ping pong game. It was that ring went back and forth between the two of them. It wasn't as simple as that. It had to be done by a divorce, and somehow he was going to do it privately. So they were at that point spoken of as husband and wife. Then would come the time, usually within a year or about a year later, of the actual marriage. And the marriage had several parts to it. It began with the procession of the groom to the bride's house. And at the bride's house, the groom would be presented with his bride. They would then come back in a procession again, coming this way. And you remember these processions because they become important. Can you think of any procession stories? You remember Jesus telling the story of the bridesmaids and the candles that, and all of that, because they were waiting for the procession to, something had happened out there at the bride's house and they were waiting for the procession to bring this all in. All of that's behind that particular story. So there's a procession back. Then there's the ceremony. We don't know an enormous amount about what happened in the New Testament time, but you know that even today, Jews, and they like to think of this as going back, and it may have roots going back all the way to the New Testament, but you know, they have New Testament times. They have the canopy over them, and then they have the broken glass that they step on to remind them of Exodus in Babylon and that they're not in the land yet. But that's become a sign of, but that shows that's probably a pretty ancient tradition. If they're crushing a glass for the sake of being away from, or Jerusalem not being free from the Babylonians. But so then they would have that. Then they would have the marriage feast, which would last for several days. And of course, we know that because of John chapter 2, marriage at Cana, Jesus' wedding, and all of the things, Jesus attending the wedding of these particular people that are there. So when it talks here about the marriage of the Lamb, it's interesting that the marriage, in one sense, has not yet taken place. Now, we think of ourselves rightly as the bride of Christ, but in the sense of the full Jewish context, we are the bride that hasn't entered into the fullness of the marriage experience yet. That is yet to come in its fullness when we are in the presence of the groom. And that's what's being anticipated here. The marriage of the Lamb has come. I guess the other part is that this is a future event. So even at this particular point, this is future. So the marriage supper of the Lamb is an event that still awaits us. Look at verse 10, there's verse 9. There's a question here, and verse 7 has said, his bride has made herself ready. And we said that represents believers. Talk about that more in just a moment. Then it says, write this, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Now, the reason I say the Greek word is called, in biblical terms, there's a difference between being invited and having been called. Having been called means you're coming. To use theological language, it is not an invitation. It is a call. It is, you're going to be there. So God's people are called. The called, whom he foreknew, he predestined, whom he predestined, he called, those he called, he justified, those he justified, he glorified. How many of those whom the Lord foreknew did he predestine? All of them. How many of those the Lord predestined did he call? All of them. How many of those whom he called did he justify? All of them. All of those whom he justified, he will glorify. I mean, it's put in the past tense. So certain is this process that what God begins, he finishes. And that's why, for example, when it says those whom he foreknew, he didn't just know about us ahead of time. That word has a whole different context about those whom he knew and set his affection on. So in the mystery of God, the foreknowledge of God is not simply that he foreknows, because God foreknows everybody. But the whole point of Romans is he doesn't justify everybody. That only happens by faith. Anyway, that's a little wandering off down it. But here's the question. Who are these who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb? And there's two answers. Pardon me. There's two suggestions. They both can't be right. One suggestion is the bride and the called are the same group. And it's just John shifting his metaphors in the middle of that. And there's others who say, no, there is another group, and that is the tribulation saints and God's people, and probably the nation of Israel are thought of in that particular way. I don't know what the right answer is. I'm inclined to think this is a separate group, and these are people who are watching and going to enjoy participating in that particular event on that occasion. Now, where does the marriage supper of the Lamb take place? It's interesting that we've got this announcement. The marriage supper of the Lamb has come. Blessed are those who are invited. And then it's never described, and we're never told where it is. And some think it takes place in heaven before the Lord comes back. I think that's extremely unlikely. I think the picture is of the Lord now about to come, and this takes place on earth after the Lord's return. Others would say, no, it happens, depending on how you put all these things together, in the new heavens and the new earth in eternity. So let's go back. We can come back and we'll talk about those things, and you may have some questions about them. I want to think a little bit about the bride. Of course, we live in a debased culture where the bride is the center of attention at the wedding. And biblically, of course, it's the man, it's the husband, it's the groom. But everybody loves a bride. So it's interesting that John describes the clothing of the bride. And I want you to notice it carefully because it tells us two different things. And both sides are true, and it's very important. The bride has made herself ready. So, the bride has prepared herself. And then it's going to go on to talk about it. So, there's something about how does the bride, now the bride is a collective, but it's also made of individual Christians. So, how does the bride make herself ready? Give me some help here. Okay, Elizabeth says she gussies up, but that's not exactly the most helpful concept. How? How does the bride make herself ready to be presented to her bridegroom? Because just like a bride today, the bride in ancient times wanted to be ready and prepared. She washes, but let's think a little theologically here. Okay. So there's something here about faith and trust. But in the context of what we've just had in the earlier part about the beast and the false prophet and true believers of God, there's something here about faithfulness and not just faith. There's something here about witness to Christ that's been spoken of. And there's something about righteous deeds. Because you'll notice in verse 8, what is the apparel of the bride? The fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. So there is a place for good works. And good works are part of the dress that we present before the Lord. Now, and we put this together theologically and biblically. There are no righteous deeds that are possible on our part. Elizabeth, I just wanted, did you remember more? Okay. You need to talk a little louder, I'm sorry for...
Well, the church was to keep herself unspotted from the world, unblemished from the world around her.
Okay, we'll come back to that, and that's... So the righteous deeds of the saints are ultimately things, though, that are produced in us because of God's work in our life, because of the Holy Spirit, but still we do them. And if you remember... Somewhere in here, and I can't tell you where, but I think before this, and by the way, there's something else here. The bride is pictured here as being with the Lord before he comes. Because you'll notice in verse 14, the armies of heaven, arrayed in fine linen, white and pure, are following him as he's coming. So he's not coming for his believers nearly so much here as coming with them. They are pictured as already being with him, and they are there dressed in these righteous deeds. Okay, we'll come back to that, but let's look at the other side of the equation. Notice what's said in verse 8. It was literally, let me read it literally. It was given to her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and clear. The fine linen was given to her. At one and the same time, she prepares herself, but she wears a garment that is given to her. And who's it given by? Well, clearly by God in this context, or by the Lamb himself. In other words, the groom is the one who is preparing the bride. Now, can you think of any place in the Bible that speaks like that? Think back to the basic passage in the New Testament about a husband and wife. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her that he might present her to himself as a spotless bride without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, so that she may be holy and without blemish. So who presents the bride with the garments? It is Christ, and yet at the same time, the bride has the righteous deeds of the saints. Is that a contradiction? Or is it the nature of the Christian life that it's the Lord working in us to purify us and to sanctify us so that we in some way will be fit to be his bride? It isn't our getting ourselves ready. And yet, beloved, it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be with him, or like him, for we shall see him as he is. Remember the next verse, 1 John chapter 3, verse 3. Everyone who has this hope set on him purifies himself as he is pure. Or another passage that comes to mind right off the top of my head, which says, the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and unworldly lusts, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world while we wait for the, what? Blessed hope, even the appearing of glory of the great God, our Savior, who purified for himself a people, what? Zealous of good works. So there's this interesting play in the New Testament, and it's especially strong in Titus, that this whole interplay that God's whole purpose is to make us not just have good works, but to be zealous for good works. And that's the product of the Lord working within us. So the bride prepares herself, but the Lord prepares the bride, and these two come together in some particular way. I find that really kind of marvelous in a way that I can't quite find words for. And then let me just close here. I mean, finish off the section. No, because there's more there than I want to do. So let's just talk about this a little bit. What occurs to you? What do you think of as we're talking about this? And this anticipation, I'm not sure, I can't prove this, but I think the marriage supper of the Lamb has something to do with Jesus saying to his disciples, I will not drink this cup again until I drink it new with you in the kingdom of God. And I think, I can't prove this, but I think that's related to the marriage supper of the Lamb, that we're going to be engaged with the Lord. And that's going to be the kind of fulfillment of all of this, because we do this. What's the statement? Do this until I come. We won't do it after he's come. We'll be drinking, not in anticipation, but the marriage will be complete. It won't be a betrothal meal. It will be a marriage meal. Sorry, Richard, to run along here. Any observations, insights, corrections?
One of the things that struck me about the passage that I was going to ask about, but I was glad that you addressed, was verse 8, when it says that the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. If I would have read, verse 8, if it would have just said she was permitted to be dressed in bright, clean, fine linen and stopped there without John's kind of commentary on the linen, I would naturally have assumed that that was a picture of the gospel, the righteous deeds of Christ,
right,
were... So it was helpful for you to kind of talk about, I guess it's a synergism between, I mean, God works in us and produces good in us. I mean, well, there's two things. I mean, we are clothed in Christ's righteousness, which is his obedience, which is separate from our obedience, but God also produces obedience in us, which is ours, because of his work, but it's, we actualize it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit like, you know, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 10, for you are his poema, his creation, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has before ordained that you should walk in them.
Yeah.
And... You know, clearly, they are ultimately the product of his work within us. But he is working within us. That's the point, too.
So I guess my question now is, I don't know if it's in Isaiah or Jeremiah where it says, I think it's in Isaiah where it says, you know, our righteous deeds are as filthy rags. Here, John describes them as fine linen. So is it the fact that as believers, one of the other gifts that God gives to us is he doesn't only sanctify, does Christ sanctify our works as they're presented, you know, in sincerity, in our best efforts? I mean, are they sanctified as well to make our works acceptable and pleasing to God? Even though they fall short.
I mean, they always will fall short of God's standard. Part of the challenge is that the Isaiah statement, I think it's in chapter 55, but I'm not sure of the particular reference, all our righteousness are as filthy rags, is speaking to them as a sinful apostate people needing to repent.
Mm-hmm.
And it's talking, in effect, it's using New Testament terminology of somewhat of an unregenerate, you know, people who have, what they're doing comes then out of an impure heart and so forth. I think the New Testament would tell us, on the other hand, that, on one level, since a good work ultimately needs to come from a pure motive, we never have pure motives this side of the redemption of our bodies. There's a refining process that does go on. And yet Paul can talk about in 1 Corinthians 3, you know, there's God's going to test our works, and it's going to be gold and silver and precious stones. He's going to search through, and there's going to be gold. I mean, that's going to be, but there's also going to be wood and stubble. And he says the day's going to reveal that. So I think the New Testament does give us the recognition that through God's Spirit within me, there are things that I can offer to him that I know are ultimately, so I won't cast our crowns at his feet. We'll know that they're in us only because of his work in us and through us. I'm not sure, Jordan, that I'm saying anything that you aren't saying. So.
No, I mean, it would be, it'd be very discouraging to think that even as a believer, all of the right things that we did were valueless before God.
I don't think that's true. I mean, he talks about, And there's a number of times in the New Testament. One of the studies I did a while ago, and I remember preaching a number of sermons in another context, another life, but the number of times the things about do what you do so to please him, and it talks about things that are pleasing to him, which is, for example, even in Romans chapter 12, present your bodies a living sacrifice, acceptable. Now in Christ, because of his mercy, in view of the mercies of God, God views things that I do now as acceptable, which means good in that context. So, yeah. It's more fun to talk about than the great prostitute, isn't it?
I can't tell you where I remember hearing it, but I remember hearing that when Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you, that's also kind of a part of this wedding pattern, that during the betrothal, the groom would go and build a home for the wife, and when it was finished, he would come back to get her, and that would be the procession. Is that accurate?
It's always hard to know how much we read into this. For example, in that passage, it's the Father's house. In my Father's house are many dwelling places, which would be like an apartment kind of thing. I'm not sure a bridal image is in that whatsoever. I mean, there's a sense in which that's true, but I think that's taking out of one context and trying to plunk it into another one. I know what you're saying because one of my professors used to preach that, but I think that's danger of trying to take one metaphor and try and squeeze it in too many places. Because I don't think any of the men sitting around the table, that when Jesus was talking late, would have thought, oh, he's thinking of us as the bride and he's going to come and take us. I doubt that was the undertone of it. Okay, time's catching us. Let me quickly talk about verse 10 and then see if there's anything there. So, in a striking way, out of this, John is so overwhelmed with all that he's heard. And the angels just comment, these are the true words of God, believe this, that we have this strange thing in verse 10. I fell down at his feet to worship him. And John all along has just had all of the discussion about false worship and worshiping the wrong things. And now he's bowing down before an angel. And the strange thing with John is, and it's, here's, I mean, there's an important lesson here. Don't confuse the message and the messenger. John had the privilege of hearing a great message, but he gave credit to the messenger rather than to the one the message was about. I got angry at times when I watched the Pope visit and I listened to people talk and I understood their enthusiasm for it, but he said, this is as close to God as you can get to anybody on earth. And his shadow crossed over me. And as I listened to that talk, I just thought, I wasn't angry about these people. I was angry at the misrepresentation that was there, that was given to him, a humble man, I think, from all appearances, holding the most arrogant position on earth. So you can call him humble, but it is arrogant in every way, in a denial of so many things in Scripture, to have a pope. So, but when I heard that, there was this kind of, but, and we all get into that. We give credit to the wrong thing. So immediately the angel steps in and says, stop doing that. I'm a fellow servant with you. And the word is actually a fellow slave. I'm only a slave. And I may be an angel, but I'm just a slave. I just serve in a different department. And I'm a fellow slave of you and your brothers who hold to the testimony of Jesus, or who hold to witness to Jesus. Worship God. God alone is to be worshiped. 4, testimony to Jesus is the essence of prophecy. Where there is a true prophet, the point is, you will always be able to tell them because they bear witness to Jesus and not to themselves. Mm-hmm. Testimony to Jesus is, now the second part is interpreted in different ways, but I think the point is the same. Testimony to Jesus is the essence of prophecy, if spirit means essence, small s, or if it means big S. Testimony to Jesus is the spirit giving prophecy. In the long run, it all comes down to the same thing. Spirit of prophecy is testimony to Jesus. It's exalting Jesus and making much of him. And I was somewhat surprised to think that that title could be given to any particular individual. And I think that borders on the very same blasphemy that John was being rebuked for in this particular place. Now, the interesting thing is, John will do this all over again in chapter 22, which is kind of encouraging. Kind of encouraging, although it's also kind of discouraging. You get an angel ball you out and tell you to worship God, and then 2 chapters later, you're bowing down to the angel again. And this time he hears the rebuke even more strongly. But it's a reminder that even the best of us, and how strong the temptation to idolatry is, and to be worshiping the wrong thing. Let's pray then. Father, as we've been reminded, apart from you and your grace intervening in our life, all our righteousness is as filthy rags. We have no claim upon you. We were dead in trespasses and sins. But you, who are rich in mercy because of great love with which you loved us, made us alive together in Christ Jesus, and has raised us up together and caused us to sit in heavenly places with Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come you might show the exceeding riches of your grace and your kindness toward us in Christ. To think that one day we will stand before you and we will be beautiful to you is astonishing to us. But we know it's because of your work in our lives. So help us to pursue holiness out of a desire to please you. In Christ's name.